In today's video, we are going to be breaking down cholesterol and separating the myths from the facts. We're going to be talking about good and bad cholesterol and what that really means. We're going to discuss dietary cholesterol and whether you should be limiting it. And we're also going to talk about how you can use your cholesterol panel to find out if you are insulin resistant. So if any of that sounds helpful to you, keep watching. Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name's Kate. I'm a certified health and nutrition coach. I post videos here on YouTube twice a week on everything from insulin resistance and blood sugar management to weight loss and sleep. So if you want to take control of your metabolic health, make sure to click that subscribe button. And you can also find me on TikTok and Instagram where I share new posts every single day. Okay, so cholesterol. This has to be one of the topics I am asked about most frequently. People are concerned that their cholesterol is too high. They're concerned about eating dietary cholesterol. And what I will say right off the bat is that there are so many misconceptions when it comes to cholesterol. Cholesterol isn't as simple as good and bad. In fact, it's actually a lot more complex than that. But I'm gonna try to simplify it today, answer all of the questions that I'm frequently asked about cholesterol, and give you the information that you need. And you can use this information to understand your results better and know what red flags to look out for. So, what is cholesterol? Cholesterol is a type of fat and an essential structural component for the cell membranes of both humans and animals. It is found in every single cell in the human body and has several functions. Some of the roles it plays include helping your body to absorb fat-soluble vitamins, so these are vitamins A, D, E, and K. It helps to create hormones, especially the sex hormones. It helps your body to synthesize vitamin D, and it maintains your cell's structure. Now, most of the cholesterol that's found in your bloodstream, which is what's tested for when you get a cholesterol test, this is actually created by the body. We can get a small amount of cholesterol from eating animal foods, but increasing or decreasing dietary cholesterol has been shown to only impact blood cholesterol levels marginally. In fact, it has such a little impact that the US dietary guidelines actually dropped it as a nutrient of concern in 2015. That's right, the US dietary guidelines no longer have an upper limit for how much cholesterol you should consume. So worrying about eating too much dietary cholesterol is pointless. It's not going to impact your blood cholesterol. And that is the first myth, that dietary cholesterol raises blood cholesterol any meaningful amount. Now, when we're talking about cholesterol, we're not actually talking about cholesterol itself, but rather what carries it. And these are known as lipoproteins. There are four types of lipoproteins, but the main two tested for are LDL and HDL. And though they are often referred to as good and bad, they are both important. And that is the next myth, that LDL cholesterol is bad. LDL is responsible for carrying cholesterol particles around the body. And HDL goes around the bloodstream and collects excess cholesterol, bringing it to the liver, where it can be used or excreted. So neither is good or bad, they both play a role. But here's where things start to get a bit tricky. Having high LDL has been associated with a greater risk of heart disease, and that is why there are concerns over having high cholesterol. A lot of people who eat a low-carb ketogenic diet can sometimes see a rise in their LDL when they make this diet change. We're going to touch more on that in just a second. But looking at LDL alone is actually not a good indicator of our heart disease risk, and it's not a good indicator of our overall health. The studies that have found an association between high LDL levels and an increased risk of heart disease have shown just that, an association. The reality is that the vast majority of people who have heart attacks actually have what is considered to be normal LDL levels. And simply lowering LDL does not decrease your risk. In fact, in one study where they lowered the LDL of participants into a range considered optimal, after 3 years, the total mortality was twice as high in the group that lowered their LDL as compared to the group with higher LDL. It is well known that for older populations, so for people over the age of 60, increased LDL is not associated with heart disease, and it's actually inversely associated with all-cause mortality. And this is the next myth, that lowering your LDL cholesterol decreases your heart disease risk. There is a much stronger association with insulin resistance and heart disease. Although insulin resistance goes so largely undiagnosed that most people don't realize the connection. So what is a better indicator of heart disease risk if looking at LDL alone isn't enough? As previously mentioned, being insulin resistant significantly increases your heart disease risk, along with your risk of developing type 2 diabetes, dementia, PCOS, and more. But still looking at your blood cholesterol panel, there are actually two other numbers besides LDL that can give you a better indicator of your overall health. These numbers are your HDL cholesterol and your triglycerides. We already discussed what HDL is, and triglycerides are the amount of fat that's in your blood. So triglycerides you want to be lower, ideally less than 1.7 millimoles per liter or 150 milligrams per deciliter, and HDL you want to be higher, ideally over 1 millimole per liter or 50 milligrams per deciliter. And these are the reference ranges that practitioners recommend. However, as soon as they see LDL is high, they don't even look at anything else. And that's concerning because the ratio between triglycerides and HDL has actually been shown to be a much better indicator of heart disease risk, with one meta-analysis concluding, although some lipid variables were associated with the extent of coronary disease, the ratio of triglycerides to HDL cholesterol showed the strongest association with extent. You can find your ratio by dividing your triglycerides by your HDL. Make sure to calculate it in milligrams per deciliter though, and not millimoles per liter. You're gonna get the wrong number if you do the latter. And this is because millimoles are actually different values depending on what you're measuring. I've mentioned triglyceride to HDL ratio before in my videos, and I've mentioned that it needs to be calculated in milligrams per deciliter, and I've been called out in the comments saying it shouldn't matter. It does matter, trust me, I understand basic math. But to convert triglycerides from millimoles to milligrams, you need to multiply it by 89. And to convert HDL, you need to multiply it by 39. So then you can calculate your ratio. Just wanted to put that out there because I know I'm gonna get that comment. A ratio under 1.9 is considered optimal. A ratio of 2 to 3 indicates moderate heart disease risk. And a ratio over 3 is a strong indicator of heart disease risk. And these values are also indicators of insulin resistance. That is how much the two are connected. But anyways, guys, this was just a quick video summarizing cholesterol and busting some myths. I hope that you found it helpful. If you do calculate your ratio, let me know what you got in the comment section down below. Remember to give this video a thumbs up just before you leave. And if you would like early access to all of my videos, consider becoming a channel member. If you did enjoy this video, you might also enjoy my video on the best foods you can eat for insulin resistance. You can check it out here. If you want to catch up on my most recent upload, you can find it here. And if you want to check out my new insulin resistance masterclass and meal plan that's coming soon, you can find it here. Thanks guys, I'll see you next time. Bye.